Good morning, ladies and gentlemen, and welcome to You on Africa. Niger is holding these elections, the 2016 elections, in a very tense political environment, but also in an environment characterized by an increase in the attacks launched by the radical Islamist group Boko Haram. That's very important to mention. The political tension that the country is experiencing is nothing new, because looking at the history or political trajectory of Niger, particularly since the 1990s, the country has had episodes of political tension, some of which led to the intervention of a military to really stop the democratization process. The first of its genre came in 1996, when a dispute between the president, Mahamadou Ousmane, and a prime minister, Mahamadou Issoufou, who is the current president of Niger, led to an institutional crisis favoring the first military coup of the post-transition in Niger. The second intervention of the army came 10 years later, in 2009, when President Mamadou Tanja decided to extend his term in office despite having completed already two terms in as president of the country. That also has led to a military coup that put a stop to Niger democratization process. A transition that was organized in 2010 by the military junta brought Niger back to democratic path. But many challenges remain in terms of the consolidation of democratic gains for the country. And the 2016 elections now present Niger with a double challenges, I would say, in terms of the stake. The first one is that those elections stand as a very important step toward the consolidation of a democratization process. The challenge here for Niger is to hold free, transparent, and credible elections whose results are accepted by all parties. The second one is to be able to develop a clear response, effective responses to the dire socio-economic needs affecting the majority of the citizens. And let us not forget that Niger is one of the poorest countries in the world. And finally, is to conduct this electoral process or the political process so as to avoid another intervention of the military in the political arena. Now, can Niger be able to respond to some of those challenges? Who are the key actors? Here we identify three sets of actors. The first one, of course, that will be very instrumental in this electoral process is the ruling party, Le Parti Nigérien pour la démocratie et le socialisme, Niger Party for Democracy and Socialism, PNDS, leading the country now with our President Mahamadou Issoufou. PNDS came into being in the early 1990s and has played a very important role in the democratic debate. I think it was also part of the very first post-national conference government that was put in place in Niger before defecting or moving out of government to play the role of the opposition. In 2011, the PNDS succeeded in winning presidential elections with the support of a dissident for another former ruling party, the National Movement for Social Development, MNSD, at that time led by Mamadou Tanja. The support provided by Ama Amadou, who moved from the MNSD, provided the PNDS of Issoufou with close to 20% of the vote, allowing him to win the presidential elections, but also to have a majority in the parliament. 2 years later, then, the conflict tension between President Issoufou and Ama Amadou appointed or elected a speaker of the national parliament led to the split between the two men, and Ama Amadou will have to quit the government on the allegation that he is involved in child trafficking, which is under the which fall under the criminal act of Niger. But since he left the government coalition, the government, I would say the PNDS, has managed to maintain the majority in the parliament by co-opting former opposition leaders in through a strategy that many political opponents consider as an approach to break the existing opposition in Niger to weaken their influence. In fact, I would say that the PNDS, the ruling party, enjoys currently the advantage of incumbency. They have control over the resources of the country, so to enable them, that will enable them to campaign successfully. But also, I think the government can put forward some of the socio-economic realization of the country, including investments in building infrastructure, road infrastructures, and other kind of infrastructure across the country, and also its ability to maintain a relative peace and stability in Niger, in spite of some of the security challenges hanging over the country. There is this belief within the ruling party that the president is likely to win a first round knockout in this electoral process. Time will tell. Talking about the ruling party also brings us to talk about the opposition parties in Niger at this stage. We identified the fact that the opposition is now gathered around two main blocks. The first one is what we call the Alliance for the Republic, Democracy and Development, ARDR in short, and the second one is the Patriotic Republican Front. That has been put in place in fair to follow on the electoral process, to raise issues and to put pressure on the government, calling upon the government to address some of those contested issues that might simply affect the credibility of the electoral process. While the ARDR is essentially made of a political party, the FPR is made of political parties, civil society organizations, trade unions, and other independent actors that really have stake in the electoral process. In fact, their aim is simply to make sure that the election takes place in an environment of transparency and credibility and avoid a dispute that might also warrant the intervention of the army. Yet, it's extremely difficult to believe that the opposition will go to this election united. In fact, the approach is that each party will file a candidate, and later on, if there is any eventuality of a runoff, they will throw their weight behind the candidate of the opposition, which might have better score. It's quite difficult to say, because that approach, tested as well, has not been productive because of what is called now in West Africa the syndrome of first round knockout. But also a very important element that I need to put forward is the political experience in Niger reveals some kind of consistency in the voting patterns of the citizen. And in that context, you can identify three main regions in Niger out of eight electoral districts that the country identified, that the country put in place. Those three really play a significant role in the electoral process of Niger at any given time. These regions include Zende, Agadez, which is dominated by Maman Ousmane, the leader of CDS. The second one is Maradi, which is dominated by the party that is now playing the role of leading opposition movement in Niger, the MNSD. And finally, you have Zinde. So those three parties represent some of the major players in Niger. The third one is the PNDS, which is a ruling party, but has a control over tower or northern the southern part of Tawa, the northern part remained disputed with other political parties. So we can see here in clear that the balance of power might be in favor of the opposition parties if one puts together numerically what they gathered during the last elections. The three main actors of the opposition parties managed to get more than 51% of the votes during the last elections. And if they have to present a single candidate for these elections, they are likely to pose some serious challenges to the ruling party. But the ruling party is also very much convinced that with the approach that has been put in place to win even supporters of the opposition parties and to keep them within its ranks, the party is capable of winning the elections. After talking about the parties, the ruling parties, actors in the opposition movement, a third actor, which I think is very important for this brief, is the army. Not that the army will present a candidate for the elections, but because of the role that the army played in the political process in Niger. And I'll give you some facts that will maybe help you understand it better. The army is a very important actor in Niger for the simple reason that it has fought two major Tuareg-led insurgencies. One, Tubu, which is another ethnic group in Niger, led insurgency, which is three major wars, internal wars. For the past 50 years, or I would say in the 50 years post-independent period in Niger, the army has spent 22 years in power in terms of military regime, so half of it. 6 out of the presidents that have ruled in Niger so far are military officers. Since 1964 up to 2010, military officers were majority of cabinets, of 40 cabinets out of the 50 that the country has known. And most of them have recycled, which gave the army a very important role in the political process in Niger. Lately, the army has decided or tried to move from coup plotters for power to what I will call the watchdog for democracy. Its last two interventions in Niger in 1996 to stop to put an end to a political crisis that emanated from the dispute between the prime minister and the president was the first attempt to put back Niger on the path of democracy. In 2009, with the contention around the amendment of the constitution that will allow President Mamadou Tandja to stand for the third term, the army really intervened once more to really help Niger to return to democracy. Does it mean that the army is now registering itself into a very important check on the democratic process of Niger? Only future can tell. And finally, in terms of actors, we're looking at the external actors and the role that they are playing. But at this stage, and what the research in Niger has revealed, is that the authorities in Niger wanted to make this electoral process a matter of national sovereignty. The government has decided to fund fully the electoral process and has not received any financial support from any external actors so far, which means the external actors are not yet very active or involved in the process. Yet, I think the doors are open. The authorities remain very open to any assistance that might come, be it in the form of technical assistance or any financial support that will help to hold free and fair election, particularly in terms of voting tabulation, vote tabulations, the transport of the voting materials, but also the transport of the electoral results, particularly from very remote and very remote areas. That generally cause problems and raise suspicions about attempts to fraud. Now, let us look briefly at the electoral process itself and how ready, how prepared the country is to hold those elections. So far, the institutional and the normative framework is in place. The country has the electoral monitoring bodies in terms of the constitutional court responsible for the elections. I think the Constitution will receive the results and proclaim the final result. The National Electoral Commission is also established, which will supervise the planning and the holding of the election. We'll collect the results, proclaim the provisional result, and transmit them to the Constitutional Court for a final proclamations. The country has also put in place a committee, a national committee, for the establishment of a voter roll. It was supposed to be biometric initially, but given the time frame, but also the resources that need to be invested, they have decided to move to the classic voter roll, which will be compiled through the door-to-door census approach. And this is where the key problem is in Niger as we speak. The process was supposed to be completed by the end of November, and the committee, special committee, was supposed to take to hold a meeting this morning to discuss. But the last information that we got is that the meeting took place perhaps yesterday, but if the consensus has been reached, no progress has been made on this this issue. There are serious problems arising from the voter rolls. I think people were talking about omissions, they're talking about duplication, they're talking about the registration of minors and the foreigners in the voter rolls. All that needed to be cleaned, to be dealt with before the elections. The country only has months before all those problems is resolved, and given that time frame and the challenges ahead, it's quite difficult for them to meet the deadline. Now, talking about the elections also will involve the security environment in which those elections are taking place. And we know geographically, Niger is situated at a very volatile and dangerous region, I would say. The southern Libya remains extremely volatile and populated by extremist groups. The notorious one among those groups is Al-Murabitoun, the group led by Mokhtar Ben Mokhtar. Mokhtar Ben Mokhtar has already attacked Niger three times in 2013, in Agadez, in Alite, even in Niamey. Niger also has to contend with the security threat coming from the northern Mali, with the proliferation of radical groups and insurgent group in that region. But the most pressing security challenge for Niger currently is from the southeastern part of the country, and is characterized by the repetitive and recurrent attack of Boko Haram, particularly in Diffa. The group has already attacked that region five times. I think a long time ago, many people believe that the group has already infiltrated that region because of the linguistic proximity between the Kanuris who lived on both sides of the border. But it's only this year that the group has really targeted specifically in that area in Niger, certainly in the search of a new base to reestablish itself after suffering the defeat due to the attacks launched by the coalition forces, the government coalition forces against the organization lately. One needs to stress that Niger has put in place a counterterrorism strategy articulated around the military component, socio-economic component, but also the reinforcement of the capacity of a legal infrastructure, normative framework put in place in the country. Yet, if the fight against the terrorism has met the consensus of many political actors, there are concerns that are raised that the government is taking advantage of the fight against terrorism to stifle freedom of expression and simply compromise the democratic rights of Niger citizens. And they even believe that the government might use this as an excuse to hold fraudulent elections, which the opposition leaders are not prepared to to accept. So the context in which the 2016 elections are taking place in Niger remain extremely worrying for the country. But we hope and that they might be able to establish and reach consensus on some of the key consensus issues, which are four basically. The first one is the independence of the electoral monitoring bodies. The second one is the credibility of a voter registration process. The third one is look at the schedule of the electoral process and see if there's a possibility of a postpone. I think I will leave it to that. Thank you for your attention.